Good evening. My name is Peter. I have the privilege of serving as the youth pastor here at Bethel. And we just want to welcome you to Good Friday. It's not a normal service. It's not meant to be. Not meant to be treated just like every other service. And as I was thinking about it, I think there's a danger in Good Friday, and the danger is that we would numb our hearts to it. If you're like me, you've grown up in the church, and you've gone to as many Good Friday services as you are old, right? And it's easy to just lose the weightiness and the heaviness of what Good Friday is about. And so I just challenge you, if that's you, if you have grown up in the church, if you've been in the church for a long time, if you've followed Jesus for a long time, don't numb your heart to tonight. And don't just say, well, I'm exempt from this because, man, I trusted in Jesus a long time ago. You're going to miss this. And I don't want that for you. I came across this quote by Charles Spurgeon, and I think this should be our attitude for tonight. It says, Lord Jesus, we come as we are. This is how we came at first, and this is how we come still. With all our failures, with all our transgressions, with all and everything that is what is not, it's not meant to be, we come to thee. And if you're here and you don't know Jesus, and you haven't trusted him as Savior, and you have questions, and you have doubts, or you've been burned by the church, and you're not really sure why you're here, but you want to check it off the list, I challenge you to keep your heart and your mind open. Something might happen tonight. I don't know. But don't close your heart and your mind off to it. So we're going to enter into a time of worship. And as we do that, let's keep our hearts open to what God might do. Cross.
Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd, armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priest and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with him. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do you what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward and seized Jesus and arrested him. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. A servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. Then he went out to the gateway, where another servant girl saw him and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again and said with an oath, "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you're one of them. Your accent gives you away." Then he began to call down curses and swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately, a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the words of Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. "He trusts in the Lord," they say. "Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It is melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish?
Sacred head now wounded with grief and shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded with thorns thine only crown. How pale thou thou, my Lord, hast suffered was all for sinners' gain. Mine, mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Lo, here I fall, my Savior, 'tis I deserve thy place. Look on me with thy favor, and grant to me thy grace.
He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that brought us peace, and by his wounds we are healed. We are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. Yet the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth.
I have a confession, so I thought I'd make it here. I love action movies. I love action movies, but not just any action movie. I love the action movies where the main character, the good guy, the protagonist, they're beaten up, they're tossed around, those they love are mistreated and hurt. I don't enjoy that part, obviously, but it's like it builds this anticipation in my heart. And those kind of movies, they just grow this sense that something's got to be done here. Somebody's got to step in and somebody's got to save the day. Somebody's got to end this. And it's like the worse the injustice is, the more the anticipation builds. And it grows and it grows until I just can't take it anymore. But then every time in these movies, it's like things are darkest and most hopeless and most painful, and there's a turn. There's a turn, and then the good guy gets back what's his. Everything flips. And justice comes. And I love that. Something inside of me is satisfied because justice is served and all is right with the world again. And I don't think I'm the only one whose heart is stirred at injustice. So I have to admit that when we come and each year we spend a night, a Good Friday, and we focus on the events leading up to the crucifixion and death of Jesus, I get uncomfortable. Because it's like reading the script to a movie that honestly, I don't think I would go to. Because in this story, the real story, our hero is pushed around. He's punched in the face. He's mocked. He's spit on. He's brutally beaten. Wrongly accused. And normally this would be the setup for the ultimate comeback, right? It's darkest before the dawn. But on Good Friday, in the real story of Jesus, on Friday there's no comeback. He doesn't get any vengeance. He doesn't get justice. Instead, he just tastes defeat over and over and over again. And here stands Jesus, battered, bloodied, beaten, and weak. And if I'm honest, I don't like this picture. I don't like this picture because it stands in contrast with the heroes of my mind and the action heroes of the movies. Instead of fighting back and getting his revenge, Jesus chose a different way. A way that appeared like weakness, but in reality, it required unmatched strength. I don't know if we have this on here, that first slide, Liam. Jesus chose to be betrayed, humiliated, and abandoned. And it's this dynamic that, like, as Seth said, hey, I want you to do Good Friday. And I'm like, okay. He says, just read through the account. Read through what happens, right? What sticks out to you? This has kept coming back to me over and over and over again. Jesus chose to be betrayed, humiliated, and abandoned. And I want to look at that. I want to look at these three different scenes leading up to the cross, starting with betrayal. In Matthew 26, 47 through 50, it says, while he was still speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign saying, the one I will kiss is the man, seize him. And he came up to Jesus at once and said, greetings, Rabbi. And he kissed him, a sign of friendship. And Jesus said to him, friend, do what you came to do. And they came upon him and laid hands on Jesus and seized him. See, over the 3 years of Jesus' ministry, thousands of people, thousands, listened to Jesus, followed Jesus, were fed by Jesus, were healed by Jesus. So many. But only 12 had the privilege of being in his inner circle. Only 12 were given the secrets of the kingdom of heaven. Like Jesus says in Matthew 13:11. And yet, even in his position as one of Jesus' disciples, Judas betrays Jesus with a kiss on the cheek and 30 pieces of silver in his pocket, which just so happens to be the same amount that the life of a slave was worth to a master in the Old Testament. I know for myself, I have narrow categories of strength and weakness. And if I feel like I'm out of control, like I'm in control, I feel strong. And I feel like if I'm out of control, I feel weak. Jesus seemed completely out of control of the events leading up to his death. Yet he was perfectly in control. And he chose submission to the Father instead of his own preferences. Humiliated. Matthew 27, starting at verse 24, it says, so when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, He took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves. And the people answered, his blood be on us and our children. Then he released for them Barabbas. So every year there was a Passover custom that the crowds, the people, got to release a prisoner of their choosing. And instead of choosing the man who had fed thousands, healed many, opened the eyes of the blind, unstopped the ears of the deaf, raised people from the dead, preached a kingdom coming of peace, they chose the other man. A known thief, murderer, and someone who was in prison for starting an insurrection in Rome. But they wanted that man. They wanted him instead. And Jesus to be crucified. At the end of verse 26, it says, Pilate, having scourged Jesus, delivered him up to be crucified. And even though it's just three words in verse 26, the scourging of Jesus would have been perhaps the most horrific pain and humiliation that he endured on his way to the cross. To put it in perspective, Roman citizens weren't even allowed to be scourged. It was illegal for them to be scourged. Two Roman legionnaires would have performed the scourging armed with a cat of nine tails, an instrument of torture with a handle, with nine long strips of leather, with pieces of bone and metal connected to them to add weight and to add ripping power. According to one source I found, it's estimated that one lash of one strip, so we're not talking the whole thing, one lash of one strip likely would have caused a cut 2 inches long and 3/4 of an inch deep. Now you add 9 strips, 2 legionnaires, and that one cut likely would have caused about 20 stitches today. One lash with 9 strips, if you do the math, it's about 180 stitches. Now, Jewish law said you can't whip someone, a criminal, more than 40 times. It's illegal. So the Jews wouldn't do it. They would whip people 39 times. But these were Romans. They weren't beholden to Jewish law. So there's really no way of knowing how many times Jesus was lashed. But what we do know is that many who were scourged died. They died in the process. And that Jesus was scourged so badly that he only lasted a few hours on the cross. One of the points of scourging was to rip up skin, bone, muscle, and to leave it exposed. So that when you're on the cross, hanging, suffocating, birds could come, land on you, and pick at your flesh. This is the scourging that Jesus went through. But it goes on. In verses 27 through 30, it says, then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters. They gathered the whole battalion before him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand, and kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. And they spit on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. and led him away to crucify him. In my head, I had always imagined that this part of the story was maybe comprised of two or three Roman soldiers standing around Jesus, putting the crown of thorns on his head, a scarlet robe on his back. But it says that the whole battalion gathered before him. A battalion is a tenth of a Roman legion. A legion is 6,000 men. A battalion would have been 600. Jesus wasn't humiliated privately. He wasn't humiliated and belittled and mocked behind closed doors. This was a public humiliation at every turn, paraded around and put to public shame. See, we think weakness is when someone puts you down and you don't retaliate. We think strength means never allowing anyone to put you down. Jesus allowed himself to be mocked, insulted, and beaten beyond recognition. Yet he never retaliated. He endured the humiliation and he never fought back. And instead of the action heroes, rather than taking matters into his own hands, he took matters and he entrusted them into the hands of the Father. Jesus was abandoned. In every great movie, the hero isn't left without help. Somewhere along the line, even if they're a lone wolf, someone comes in and helps them to help the cause, but not so with Jesus. The men he had invested 3 years of his life and ministry turned their backs on him and ran away. No one came to rescue him from his fate. But that wasn't the betrayal that would have caused Jesus the most pain. It was the separation from the Father. The one who he had enjoyed perfect unity and harmony with until this very moment. Jesus experienced what all those who reject him will experience someday. Separation from God and being cut off from life itself. And yet he did it willingly. We think weakness is when you're left without friends or family to stand by your side. We think strength means never being alone. But Jesus was cut off from everyone. And far more significantly, he was cut off from the Father. But there's this verse back in Matthew 26 that I just have not been able to stop thinking about. It's back to the betrayal. When you start in verse 51, it says, "Behold, one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his ear," likely Peter, "or stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear." Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place. For all who take the sword will perish by the sword." And here's the verse. Here's the verse that has helped me think differently about the suffering and death of Jesus. It says, "Don't you think that I couldn't appeal to my Father and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels?" If he wanted to, in that moment, Jesus could have called out, said the word, and 72,000 angels would have been there in an instant. Throughout the Bible, every time someone encounters one angel, they fall on their face in fear. This is 72,000 angels. And Jesus is saying, all I need to do is say the word, and they would be here. And this could be over. But Jesus never said the word. He didn't stop the affliction, the pain and humiliation. Like a lamb that's led to slaughter and like a sheep that's before its shearers, so we open not his mouth. And this is the piece where it's like, as I watch these movies, the best part is when the hero gets the comeback in the end. And no matter what terrible things ends up happening to the bad guys, I don't care. Because they deserve it. And I read the story of Jesus like I just want something to happen to these people who mock him and spit on him and humiliate him. But it never comes. And Jesus could have made it happen. He could have stopped them. And it makes the words of Matthew 27:46 all the more painful, because from the cross, Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? He could have said the word and given everyone what they deserved. He could have won. But this is where every action movie falls desperately short. Because they convince us that we should take justice into our own hands. They convince us that our strength should be wielded in our own way. And that our vengeance should be swift and final. But Jesus was after something bigger and more glorious. Jesus chose to be betrayed, humiliated, and abandoned to save us. Here's the irony. That desire for justice, that like, oh, I just want them to get what they deserve. I just want them to be put in their place. I just want the evil to stop. That's a good desire, but if you follow it back, you know where it leads? If you follow it all the way back and you want true justice, it means that you and I are hanging on the cross. It's not Jesus. It's not Jesus taking the nails through his hands and the nails through his feet. But it's you. And it's me. It's not Jesus who's getting the flesh ripped from his body, but the cat of nine tails, but it's you. And it's me. It's not Jesus who's being humiliated, but it's us. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. Isaiah 53:4 says, surely he has borne our griefs. He's carried our sorrows. Verse 5 says, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. It was by his suffering that we have peace, and by his wounds that we are healed. The sinless Jesus became sin in order to take our sin from us. Jesus didn't endure the betrayal, humiliation, and abandonment because he had to. He didn't do it because he was powerless to stop it. He did it because he chose to. He did it in order that he could take the punishment that you deserved. And that I deserve. For every addiction, that's left unsaid, for every affair that's hidden, for every lie ever told, for every murderous thought in your head, for every hateful word and biting comment. Jesus hung on the cross. He chose to take our punishment so that we could have his life. So the question is, how will we respond? I think the only proper response is worship. The proper response is not, okay, God, how can I repay you? Okay, God, what do I have to do to make this right, to clear my name so that I don't feel guilty about this anymore? That's not the proper response. There is no amount of good you can do to make up for what Jesus has done. You can't pay him back. You can't balance the spreadsheet. But you can accept the gift that he's offering. The gift of his life that came through his death. The gift that leads to eternal life. And we can worship him with our lives. Not just tonight, but every night. And not just today, but every day. And stretching on into eternity. For we are not our own. We were bought with a price. So let's honor God with our bodies by worshiping him. Let me pray. God, I don't feel very comfortable reckoning with the fact that you took the punishment that was reserved for me. God, I so badly want to feel like I've done enough to repay you, but I can't. God, I just pray that we would not walk away thinking that this is just another verse in the Bible. It's just another night at church. It's just another reason to walk away and say, man, Christians are crazy. They worship this guy who was nailed to a piece of wood. God, would you change our hearts? Would you help us feel the weight of our sin? Because the more deeply we feel the weight of our sin, the more deeply we understand your love for us. God, the crucifixion of Jesus, it's not pretty. It's because our sin is not pretty. And it separates us from you, God. But you have made a way. God, help us not to walk away from that. Help us not to think that's not a big deal to turn our back. God, we love you, and we're so grateful for the old rugged cross. Pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So one practical step to respond in worship is by taking communion together. So if you're serving communion, if you want to come up to the front, there's going to be people throughout the front of the stage. And we just ask, not that you have to be a member to take communion. You don't have to be a regular attender even. But we do ask that you're a follower of Jesus. And then if you're not, that you don't partake in it. And as you come up, and as you take communion, I want you to think, what is going on in your own life that seems so unbearable, so challenging, so suffocating that you just don't know what to do about it? And to remember Jesus on the cross, taking the weight of your sin for you. And if you're sitting here and you don't know Jesus, maybe tonight's the night. Maybe tonight's the night that you make it right with him. You confess your sin and your need. It'll be a glorious thing. Let's take communion together. Free option by the steps if you need that as well. And if you can't get up, someone will come around and bring the elements to you.
comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin has just game.
you pray with me? God, Good Friday is not good because it feels good. It's not good because it gives us warm fuzzies inside. It's not good because it's comfortable. It's good because Jesus is good. Our sin is not good. It's heavy. It decays everything it touches. But it's on the cross, as the blood of Jesus ran red, where the power of sin and death was broken. We don't leave Good Friday without hope. We leave Good Friday expectant of what is to come. God, but would our sin be heavy on us tonight? And would your grace be heavier? Would it weigh on us? Lord, and if we're here and we don't know you, we haven't accepted and chosen to follow you as Lord, would it rest heavy? Would you pursue hearts, Jesus, until they find rest in you? We pray this in your name. Amen. As we go, just remember, Jesus didn't have to die on the cross. He wasn't powerless to stop it, but he chose to, for you and for I.